Hey everyone, it's Jim
and Charles
from Valves and More, an online vintage tube store. And today in Tube Lab number 144, we're going to talk about the E-1148 Triode. And we're actually going to listen to a couple of different variations on or setups of the tube live and see what you think. But first, caution everyone, electronics and tube amplifiers can have very high voltages present, which can be lethal. Exercise extreme caution when working around them. Always consult a professional technician when in doubt. Well, sometimes it feels like we are really lucky, and then I remember the long hours we put in to get to the point of feeling lucky. Well, recently we did get truly lucky when we found an almost full case of triodes, new in the box, all from 1942 and 44, almost certainly World War II surplus. Imagine that, finding 80-year-old war surplus in quantity still in 2023. Well, the tube we found was the Hytron
E-11.
I knew I got that. It's programmed in my brain wrong. Thank God Charles is here.
All day saying EL-34 and it's really messing things up.
Well, that's true. I was dealing with some questions about the EL-34 and it's just... Anyways, don't get old, folks.
E-1148.
Thanks, Charles. It's also known by many other designators like the CV6 and the
2C22 and 6C8C, I think, is another one.
Yeah, there's a lot. That's the Soviet one, I think. Anyways, there's lots of them. Anyways, this was the prototype number that Hytron, or maybe even the Pentagon, designated the tube with. And I'm guessing the E in the front means experimental. Now, for fun, we thought we'd have a look at what a brand new 80-year-old tube, new in the box, looks like when it first comes in. Charles, did you want to unbox the one that we saved?
Yeah, okay. So we've already unboxed all of the other guys here, but we saved this one just for you. This is actually one of the nicest looking boxes out of the entire batch because unfortunately they were not stored very well. And that's pretty common with these older tubes. So you can see we've got this great military box. We've got E-1148 here. And I don't think Dad mentioned it earlier, but this is actually considered to be a prototype for the other versions of the tube. If you look at the data sheet for it, it says production prototype. So it's pretty interesting that it actually did go into production for a time, which says something about World War II production.
Well, I mean, it was a fight for survival. And I think, you know, a new tube going from design to prototyping to production might have taken 1 or 2 years before the war. Mm-hmm. But with, you know, a war on two fronts, one in Europe, one in the Pacific, I bet you they went from prototyping to, yeah, we need these. How many thousands can you make a week? Yep. And they probably made that decision inside of what, a month or two.
And you see that with a lot of things during the war. So this guy is actually dated for 644. And I'd say maybe about 2/3 of the case were dated here when we have some earlier ones from 42 that have some minor differences. Let's get this thing open and take a look. So this is actually an interesting box. I haven't seen any like this before where you actually have to break these open in order to get it out. So you get to enjoy this with me here.
Well, you did, what did you do? 46 of them so far, and how many boxes were you able to save?
Practically none.
Yeah.
Yeah,
this was the good one.
Yeah, these are so fragile, they just disintegrate here. Lots of box dust in here, too. Don't breathe that in. You can see it falling out here.
Well, hopefully no critters fall out.
Yeah, and let's bring it out this way. And here we go. So there is a new old stock, a new in box, Hytron E-1148. Also known as the CV6. And you can see how filthy they are just out of the box here. The other ones took a while to clean up.
Now, Hytron, of course, was a famous tube manufacturer that made really good quality stuff. Not in huge quantities. I mean, for the war effort, I think the war production tubes probably really got them going.
Oh, yeah.
But they made such good tubes that CBS was contracting broadcast grade tubes from them. Mm-hmm. And eventually they ended up buying Hytron, and we ended up with labels changing to CBS Hytron.
Yeah, for a while it was CBS Hytron, and then I think they just switched over to CBS.
Yeah.
But you can see, look how much corrosion there is on the pins here, on the top caps, and this is a new tube. Now, but it's probably been sitting somewhere that's a bit damp, maybe...
Probably a building that's a little bit open to the weather, like a barn mm-hmm. or an old warehouse. So you clean these all up.
I clean these all up here.
So what do they look like when you've got them cleaned up?
There's an example of a fully clean one. This one has slightly different labeling, but it came from the same batch here. And you can actually see the VT number for the tube right there. So that's another designator for it.
Yeah, and the VT number was the Pentagon number.
Mm-hmm. And this is actually a slightly different revision as well. If I tilt it up here, you can see this one has an interesting upside down cup getter holder, while these other versions have just a simple sort of rectangular bar. And that means that this one is slightly earlier production. I believe it's 1942 this one was produced. But otherwise, they are the exact same tube, and they sound quite great. Really interesting construction, how they put the triode right at the top to try and minimize the differences, or the distance between the leads. And
because this was, of course, a radar tube in the Second World War, but it was still a triode.
It was still a triode. It was still based on the 6J5, so it means it's a medium mu sort of general purpose. But
and what does that mean? It means that if you put two of these together, you've got
something close to a 6SN7.
Which is why we get so excited about these tubes, because there's something magical that happened in the 40s, 50s, into the early 60s with vintage tubes. The Sonics, you rarely hear that quality of sound. Did you get my...
Yeah, I got the cloth dirty.
You got my cloth dirty. And I'm not doing laundry anytime soon. There's some magic with those tubes that you rarely hear after the early 1960s. Mm-hmm. And we're really into that sound.
Yeah.
That warm, rich...
But we're always looking for these beautiful vintage tubes, and getting more into the single triodes now too. So, yeah.
And you've got a similar tube, but the later iteration.
Yeah, so this is another example of a new old stock tube that was actually well packaged, well stored. But this one is... Let me see if I can get it. Oh, I think it's this way. There we go.
That's in Cyrillic, but in English, that's the...
That is GI3. So we've shown these tubes before, and they're sort of like the big brother of these guys right here. They were meant to push more current.
And this is a Soviet-era tube.
This is a Soviet tube, and this is beautiful original packaging. You see a lot of these old Soviet boxes with this sort of modeled cardstock that they used, and it's quite durable.
And it is rare, though, to find Soviet tubes mm-hmm. boxed like this in good condition.
Yeah. So here I'll show you the tube in a second here, but let's take a quick look at the packaging a little bit closer. And this is another thing that the Soviets often did, was include little data sheets with a lot of their packaged tubes. Let's see if I can get this open.
Yeah, even case lots. When we get a fresh case lot, they'll actually put a dozen or so of these on top of 25, 50, or 100 tubes.
Yeah, so you can grab one if you need it. And so this is, of course, all in Cyrillic, but we've got that great wing C for Svetlana, and this is all the information that you would need to work with the tube. Let's take a closer look at the tube now. Though this one we have not touched, we have not cleaned. All we've done is put a label on it, just so that you know what it's marked as in the store. And this is about the best it's going to get for something that's new old stock coming out the box in terms of how clean and nice they look.
1958 too.
Yeah, 1958. This is one of the earliest versions of this tube that you're going to find, and they just look beautiful. I mean, this would just need a little bit of a cleanup. We'd clean the pins, of course, which we always do on everything, but it hardly needs it.
But that's unusual.
That's unusual, yeah.
And you do all the cleaning, so...
I do a lot of it.
So you're grateful when you see a clean one come in.
Yeah, yeah.
And we found a whole bunch of these, all from, mostly from the 1950s.
Yeah, early to late 50s, and I think some early 60s, but they're all this general type. There's, I think, three different versions of these across the years, where they changed the number of pins. You can actually see we've got hollow pins that aren't connected. Oh, let me get that in focus. That aren't connected to any electrodes, and they ended up getting rid of those in later versions, I assume, to save material. And they also got rid of these insulators, I believe, in the later versions on these top caps.
Yeah, so, there was a number of changes. So luckily, this big lot of these Soviet-era GI3s, they're all pretty much identical, which makes matching a lot easier. And they're all new old stock, new in the box. And
yeah. Which we don't see a lot of them come in new old stock. We have some used, but it's nice to find them in a partial case like this.
Okay. Well, thanks for doing all of that work, Charles.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now, we were talking about getting lucky. We got lucky a second time when I had one of those nights filled with ideas. And I woke up with what I thought would be some beneficial design changes to the Universal 6 or 12 SN7 kit preamp. This is our oldest kit and also our best selling kit. And the design hasn't been touched since it was released. So it turns out that both of my ideas, they're already implemented. We've been listening to them. Both of my ideas are good improvements.
Yeah.
I mean, significant improvements.
I mean, we already loved the sound of it before, so it's surprising that we can still find room for improvement, but you know, we're always trying to do better with this stuff.
Yeah, I mean, one thing that maybe people don't know about when you design a piece of audio gear is that at some point the design has to be deemed to be finished. Otherwise, we'd go broke. You know, we'd be designing for years and years and improving, and there's no money coming in, and there's nothing but R&D cash going out. So, I mean, some designs, we have thousands and thousands of dollars invested before we even sell a single kit. So in a future Tube Lab, we're going to go over the two changes that I came up with and why they've improved the sound. And we'll go forward. We'll probably end up with version 3.0. Which is, I think, really fun because it was a great sounding preamp before I put the revisions in.
Yep, and we're going to have to do some more testing just to make sure that it is
really
version 3, but we're happy with the sound of it right now.
Yeah, we haven't done the technical testing. We've done the listening tests, which is the most important thing.
Oh, it has to sound good. Yep,
it has to sound great. Anyways, we're going to listen to some combinations of the E-1148... as a complete set in the adapters.
So we're running two of these in the place of a 6SN7 in our Universal Pre, and that's going to be the first track that you'll listen to. It's another segment of a Daka Braka song that we actually haven't featured on here yet, but it's a great track, and I think we're going to be bumping it into our test track list just because of the instrumentals in it.
And we're going to listen to a version in which the gain stage is going to be the 1148 and the GI3 is going to be the cathode follower stage.
Yeah, because it's great at pushing current, so it's a perfect tube for a cathode follower.
And the Universal is in its modified revised configuration, so you're actually going to hear the sonic improvements. I hope you can hear them. Anyways... Okay, Charles, well, let's get the music rolling.
All right. Okay, what did you all think of that? That's a fun track, I think.
Yeah, it's a remix, or actually, they call it the
original mix, I think.
The original mix of one of our favorite Daka Braka songs, and it's
got a great beat to it. The instruments are just a lot of fun coming in and out.
And like so many of their recordings, it's got really good definition. I mean, I think they're using a recording studio in the Ukraine, and whatever those engineers are doing, they know how to record music. It's always musical. It's lively. It's got dynamic range. It's got everything we need for a test track. I know for some people it's not their thing.
A bit different from our usual stuff, so maybe you guys are going to like it a bit more of it.
Yeah.
Let us know in the comments what you think.
Yeah, but I think the big thing was the improvements that we're hearing fairly clearly with the revisions that we put into the Universal Pre.
Mm-hmm.
The bass... I don't think the bass came up, but the bass has a level of definition that improved significantly.
Yeah, it feels more defined.
And that's right through the mid-range and treble.
Yeah, everything just seems clearer, more detailed, but not harsh to listen to like detail can sometimes bring. So we've been listening to all of our test tracks and all of our regular music that we really like to listen to with this mod, and it's just been bringing out all that great detail on them.
Yeah, and best of all, I mean, it's a universal preamp, so it plays a lot of tubes. What are some of the tubes? The 6SN7, obviously, and the 12SN7.
Yep. The 6GU7, the 6CG7, obviously the 1148 and its brother and sister tubes that we looked at earlier. There's all sorts. You can even run 12 EU7s in there with adapters.
Yeah, and they all sound great.
Yep.
And I think that's probably, I mean, that makes it a universal pre, but I think it's also a good indication of the fact that good quality tubes in a good circuit are just going to consistently sound good.
Yep.
So, and we hear that back all the time from customers. You know, a tube that we get behind that sounds good in our custom gear sounds good in their commercial amp. So that's important. Well, if you stayed this long, this is one of my favorite parts of the whole show, and that is what came in. Well,
yeah, we got to show off some fun stuff today.
Yeah. So Charles has perfected his regluing of base method.
Mm-hmm.
And you went through, did you do them all?
I did a huge number. I think I still have some left that are kind of low priority, but
yeah,
did a bunch of the high priority.
You did a lot of them. And
we're going to have a video coming up soon that goes into the changes to there. I just simplified the process a little bit, and it takes less time now.
I mean, what happens with tubes that are 70 and 80 years old is that the adhesion, between the glass and the plastic, even on brand new old stock, new in the box tubes, the adhesion just lets go. It deteriorates.
Yep. It crumbles over time.
It crumbles over time. And with your application, you can basically restore. You can see this tube it's solid again. Anyways, these are some of the most famous twin triodes ever made. These are the Sylvania Bad Boys, and a lot of people out there are calling anything and everything, even tubes that were never made by Sylvania Bad Boys.
Yeah.
Oh my God. If I messaged everybody that was yutzing about with that kind of bullshit, I wouldn't have time to run the business. Anyways.
Well, you know, scarcity is bringing these people out, so be careful when you're buying.
Yeah, be very careful. When it comes to tube sellers, things have shifted in about the last 6 months. The fraudsters are
multiplying.
They're everywhere. And we get caught every once in a while, and we know what we're doing. So anyways, be careful. So these are the Bad Boys, back-to-back T-plates. There's a plate or foil getter down low. So that means you got the waste chrome. That's how you identify these. There's a variation. This is the two rivet variation. There's a more common three rivet variation, but sonically the same. They're all made in the 1940s into I think 51 or 52 is the last year of production. Anyways, Charles found and cleaned up a matched pair. This is the Jan version, the mil-spec version. As far as we know, they're identical to the domestic version. They sound the same. They look the same. It's just a labeling difference. These went to war and these went into home radios. Yep. Anyways, that's a nice, tight, matched pair of new old stock tubes that have had their bases cleaned up, but they're not 100% cosmetically. So normally these would sell for a lot of money.
Yeah, and you know, if we're selling something as new old stock for a lot of money, we want it to be perfect, both in testing and in looks. And these aren't quite there.
So what do we do?
Well, we're going to bump them down to used.
Yep, so whoever grabs those should be really happy. We're putting a lot of time on these tubes just to make sure that they're quiet. The used version of this tube
is noisy, often.
Often noisy. Yeah. I mean, frequently would be the right word. And to the point where we don't deal with them anymore. If I can find new old stock, I will buy them and bring them in and test them. And even those we sometimes lose.
Yeah, it's just the used ones, we typically lose more than half of them in testing and noise testing. So.
And these are the early GTs. So you cannot play them in just any amp, any modern amp.
Yeah.
You can play them in the Universal. It's designed to actually safely play the GT. There's a big write-up on it in the website under the listing if you're interested. Anyways, that's the bad boys. That's it. We found one pair. And here's some good news. Every once in a while, we get in a whole bunch of my favorite EL34s. Do any of these have the real mothered labels on them? I don't know.
They would all be rebranded.
No, this is an RCA. That's a Phillips. Well, Phillips owned Mullard, so.
That's about the closest I think we're going to get.
Anyways, we got a whole bunch of these XF2s. These are the EL34s that were made in the 1960s. Last year, production was 72, I think. Got a lot of great things happened in 1970, 71, 72. The music was amazing. I was, you know, as a teenager in those years, so. FM radio was fantastic in the 70s. Anyways, I digress. So when we get a bunch of tubes in, there's often some tubes that are sort of on the margin. Now, these are used tubes, good used tubes, but they're not 100% cosmetically and electrically. They're maybe slightly mismatched. So what do?
Well, bump them down to the discount.
So there's a discount quad of Mullard EL34 XF2s in the store. And somebody will grab them, and
the discounts never last long for these tubes.
No, and the interesting thing is I get the best notes from people who grab those at that price, and they say almost every reply is like, wow, I knew they would sound good, but I can't believe how good they sound. Anyways, if you stay till the end, here's some discount codes to help you out. And somebody made a big order a couple of days ago, and they got the huge discount code.
Somebody used it. Yep.
The first one to ever use it. He didn't blow any horns or anything like that. He just grabbed the money. and there's a smaller hidden code that's easy to figure out as well. And we've got flight rate shipping around the world of $20, we can reach almost everybody.
Almost everybody.
And if yours is $150 or more after discount, the shipping's on us, folks. Stay safe, everyone. This is Jim.
And Charles.
Signing off. Cheers, everyone.